Tamil Nadu election is witnessing some interesting candidates filing their nomination. One such candidate is Rangarajan Mohan Kumaramangalam, the great-grandson of the late Paramasivan Subbarayan, who was once the Chief Minister of Madras Presidency. He is contesting from Omlur constituency in Salem district. Mohan left India when he was 18 to pursue higher education in the United States. After a brief stint as an entrepreneur, he returned to India in 2011. Ever since, Mohan has been active in politics, being part of the Youth Congress.
When you were filing the nomination, we saw a huge crowd, perhaps, that I haven't seen for any other leader. What draws the crowd? Is it the legacy? Is it the hope? Or is it the anti-incumbency factor that draws crowd?
I think it's probably a combination of all. I think maybe hope comes, obviously I've been working here for the last 10 years. So I'm actually, frankly, also a little surprised at the kind of welcome I got, because I've been working in Salem, in Omalur, in all these surrounding areas for the last 10 years. And I've had a healthy number of people come and see me and me try to help them with their problems. But I didn't expect there to be such a groundswell. I can't stop my car anywhere in the constituency without people coming up to me anymore. That was never the case before. So I'm also, frankly, a little surprised.
Wherever we travel, perhaps two factors that comes out is unemployment and the inflation.
Yes.
Now, how do you think you will address the issue of unemployment? Because a lot of youngsters feel that Salem do not have IT companies, Salem do not have manufacturing companies that they are trying to enter. So how do you think the party would address that?
A series of things, actually. Frankly, we're only 2 hours from Bangalore. And we have Yerkad as well. Right, so if you look at environment, and Salem city is a decently big city, there is no reason why we shouldn't have like an IT center there. We have a tidal park. I think the biggest mistake they made with the tidal park was that they didn't promote it properly. They gave it to Elcott. It's not actually a tidal park, it's an Elcott park. If Tidal did the marketing for it, we would be in a very different situation. Because of our proximity to Bangalore, because of the fact that we have a decent infrastructure in our city, we have all sorts of retail and entertainment options, and we have what amounts to a beautiful hill station for a weekend getaway also right there. It's perfect to have an IT park. Now, in terms of manufacturing, I know the central government has talked about building a defense corridor and has grand plans in that direction. I'm not sure how much of it will fructify, but there are a lot of cottage industries actually in Salem that can be encouraged by providing capital, access to capital. I think a lot of that is available in the market today. It's just about connecting the dots and bringing it to Omlur and Salem in specific.
Another factor we saw that Congress mentioned in the manifesto about the liquor ban. However, the ally DMK do not talk about it. How do you think you will address,
This is maybe a part of a legacy from the last time, which is that last time it was a very burning issue for Tamil Nadu. It was a very, very burning issue. We had Sasi Perumal also, who I know very well, who climbed up a tower and actually passed away as well in a quest to actually bring prohibition as a whole. My personal opinion is prohibition is very hard to implement and keep it on, a sustained basis. We need to think about how to reduce liquor consumption as a whole. There is no doubt in my mind. And there is some moral hazard about having a soup to nuts infrastructure owned only by the government to distribute liquor. I know manufacturing, of course, is not government, but everyone knows who owns the distilleries that exist. To have distribution and then retailing also be owned by government obviously creates a bad incentive. That cannot be your number one source of revenue for the state, because you're basically pouring liquor into people's mouths, damaging their health and making money, and then giving them things that they don't necessarily need, like maybe a washing machine that has been promised in this manifesto by ADMK.
How do you see the promises that the ADMK has made? Because
I see them to use a mild word, disingenuous. I don't think they are about to implement any of those things. They know they're not coming back to power. And so it is almost a matter of, okay, if the DMK alliance is promising X, let's just do X plus 2 or X into 2, something of that nature. It's not well thought out at all in terms of what's needed. And there is a problem, because a lot of the promises that were made last time have not been lived up to. So on what basis are they asking people to trust them? Whatever they've been doing for 10 years, if after 10 years you make the same promise that you made, 5 years ago, then why would people believe you?
ADMK kind of put the Congress and DMK in trouble with the one-year reservation. Do you think that will have an impact because a lot of people seem to show support because of the reservation for the AIADMK, despite all the things that has happened over the last 4 years.
So earlier I used to believe that the ADMK is being forced into an alliance with the BJP, and that this is what you would call an opportunistic alliance, not one by ideology. But what he's done with the reservation issue of 10.5% is that he's shown that it's not an opportunistic alliance, but rather an ideological alliance, where BJP operates on a level that they create vote banks by dividing people along the lines of religion. ADMK has now decided to divide people along the lines of caste in a very pronounced manner. And they've done it as they've done everything else in the last 5 years in an insincere and a half-hearted manner. If you were going to give a reservation of 10.5%, then give it forever. Why 6 months? And then why announce it at all if it's just 6 months away that you're going to be able to do a caste survey and then base it on the and put it on the basis of that? Everybody knows that it is Congress that actually is the founder of social justice reform in a way. We were the first ones to actually make the amendment in the Constitution to enforce the social justice that was enshrined in the Constitution. The reason why that came about was a case filed by people from Tamil Nadu. So Tamil Nadu has a very strong connection to social justice. I can never say that reservation is a mistake. I think it has great benefits. But at the same time, if you are going to call out only one particular community and not talk about reservation for all the other communities at the same time, then you're clearly dividing along the lines, dividing on those lines. What they could have done and what they should have done was say that there is a sincere timeline that we're going to live up to, in which we will determine the percentage of everyone's population, and then we will implement an internal reservation or a sub-reservation based on that. What they've done now is give us votes, we like you, we don't like them. And the others are livid about it.
So are you worried that certain vote bank you would be losing because of that? Or would it impact at all? How do you think?
No, I think that depends on how well we communicate to the public. It's not only us. I think many others have also criticized the way this thing has been carried out and how. What are you going to do in 6 months? What exactly are you going to do in 6 months? How many postings are you going to put out? What is the revenue basis? You know, what does your balance sheet look like as a government? How much debt do you have? I'd be surprised if this particular government, if it had ever come back, if it came back to power, would actually have the wherewithal to pay their existing employees, much less open new postings. So I don't think people are going to buy it, frankly. But that also depends on how effectively we communicate this. There is also the point that Vanyars were getting reservation upwards of 13-14% before this. So a lot of people are making the argument that they've actually, their opportunity set has been reduced.
Yeah, that's absolutely the fact. Another thing, the Salem-Chennai Expressway. We see a lot of resentment, though the matter is in the court. Now, a lot of farmers' families have decided not to vote for AIADMK. That doesn't mean that the votes would translate to DMK or the Congress. What does Congress stand on the issue?
It's a completely unworthy project and was brought in a hurry, was never really planned out. Evidence of which is available in looking at their feedback infra's feasibility report, where they cut and pasted sections from some report they made for a district in China. There is not any need for this expressway at this point. There are people who are attributing various motives to why this expressway is being built, like finally exploiting the iron ore in Kajamalai and affecting the people there, also affecting the entire ecology of Salem. So my party stand and our alliance's stand also is that the Salem to Chennai 8-lane expressway, as has been presented by the current government, including the central government, is a project that is not needed, and the livelihoods of many will be lost for something that will not have be in the greater good or the greater interest of everyone in this area.
So you're saying the party would take it up to scrap it?
Yes, absolutely, without a doubt, without a doubt. DMK, which is now on the other side of this alliance, had fought for apparently.
Perhaps one last question. Congress seemed to face the leadership crisis, and that's been happening over the years also because of the political parties kind of maligning certain leaders with their campaign. Now that has created the impression among people that look, we don't have a strong leader. Do you think that would affect your chances? How do you take that?
Tamil Nadu is one of the states where the difference between favorability ratings of Mr. Rahul Gandhi and Mr. Modi are so severely tilted in his favor that if anybody actually tries to make fun of Mr. Rahul Gandhi here, they'll probably lose votes more than they will gain votes. So I as far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, I think having Mr. Rahul Gandhi as a leader or not having him as the official president of the Congress doesn't matter, because people see him as our leader here. And whenever he goes, he attracts crowds and he adds more value and more votes to the Congress party.
What do you see as local issues when you travel here? How do you feel?
Many of the same issues continue to persist. Water issues are there everywhere, many of the places. Cooperative marketplaces have not been set up to help farmers who have shown some level of ingenuity in diversifying away from your usual crop and going to things like floriculture. Basic infrastructure has not been created for many people. Now, I'm not talking about someone's house, because someone's house, if you compare a village here to a village in UP or Bihar, it's like heaven and earth. You have piped drinking water, you have a TV, you have electricity most of the time. So all these things are, these fundamental problems for your house are fixed. But the fundamental problems that will allow you to move to the next level in your livelihood, in your economic status, are not fixed. Water still is a problem. So I said electricity, but water still is one of the biggest problems. They had allocated 600 crores to a project that has been pending for 35-40 years called the Mettur Upanir Thittam, which basically is overflow water from Mettur Dam to bring it into Salem and to all the surrounding districts, to Namakkal, etc. That portion of that has been taken to Edappadi, but nothing has come to Oberoi. They've completely skipped it. So the CM has allocated a large amount of money, or announced that he's allocated a large amount of money, and only taken advantage of it in his own constituency.
Congress manifesto also promises a law for the inter-caste marriages at a time when Vela Yatras and other things are going on.
Yeah.
How do you think we'll address, considering also the one-year Dalit issue is a big concern for many of the Dalits' families here? So would the law be a realistic goal?
Sometimes realism is not as important as idealism. And as I've always said, Congress has always been in support of social justice. And this is one more step in that direction.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Has to be seen if Mohan will succeed in tackling the complex issues of caste and reservation to enter the assembly, which once had his grandfather as the chief minister. In Salem, Prabhu Mallikarjun for the Federal.